we are dealing with an extraordinarily sophisticated, very, very ancient civilization. Examining some of the ancient Sumerian and Egyptian texts, because of course they're full of all of these references to wars of the gods and the technologies by which they were fought. That somebody of intelligence existed here millions of years ago. If it wasn't man, then it was somebody else, perhaps a precursor sort of human-like race, perhaps some sort of extraterrestrial human-like race. We don't really know. The mass of the planet that he predicted that should have lied in the asteroid belt would have been of the approximate same mass as the planet Saturn, a water-bearing solid planet that may possibly have been the home to intelligent life. Then that life is possibly going to be of much larger physiology, in other words, giant.
What we're looking at, very possibly, is an interplanetary civilization that may have existed here in the solar system, and it literally blew itself apart.
For listeners who don't know Dr. Tom Van Flandren, he was an astronomer with the U.S. Naval Observatory for many years here in the United States. And he came gradually to reject the standard astronomical theory for the origin of comets in the Oort cloud, supposed Oort cloud, that exists beyond the orbit of Pluto. And essentially what he concluded was that the asteroid belt shows all the signs of having been the remnants of an exploded planet. And in doing this, he kind of revives an astronomical theory that was quite popular in the early 19th century, and he fleshes it out a bit more by examining the geological evidence of asteroids and so on and so forth, and running a statistical computation of the origin of comets. And he discovered that if you do that, the orbits of various comets that he plots in his calculations show that this planet would have exploded at certain points in history. And he comes up with the dates of about 65 million years ago and then approximately 3.2 million years ago. If we go back and look at some of the ancient Sumerian texts or Vedic texts in the Hindu tradition, those dates also pop out as being dates where a significant catastrophe happened. One of the final things that he proposes, and he kind of leaves it hanging in the air, he doesn't even explore it any further, he just mentions deliberate action, or in other words, a war. That really set me on the path of examining some of the ancient Sumerian and Egyptian texts, because of course they're full of all of these references to wars of the gods and the technologies by which they were fought. this war probably involved civilizations or a civilization that existed on this planet, on the moon, on Mars, on the now missing planet, and then certain satellites of Saturn. A couple of American archaeologists that are very familiar with the Vedic Hindu tradition were led to write a book called Forbidden Archaeology. It's a massive 900-plus page tome. In which they examine some archaeological evidence that has more or less either been forgotten or just simply suppressed, of anomalous artifacts that are clearly the workmanship of some sort of intelligence, that occur in geological strata that are way, way earlier than the standard history would allow mankind to exist on Earth. They basically make a case that somebody of intelligence existed here millions of years ago. If it wasn't man, then it was somebody else, perhaps a precursor sort of human-like race, or perhaps some sort of extraterrestrial human-like race. We don't really know. But the clear evidence is there that somebody had to have been here in order for these artifacts to exist. One of the most famous examples that I recall them citing is a case of some very strangely machined, almost rectangular metal tubes that were found in France in a geological and archaeological dig that would have dated them to approximately 65 million years ago. Clearly, there were people of some sort of intelligence that had access to some technology that allowed them to do these things. So the idea of a cosmic war being fought at those particular time periods begins to take on a little more plausibility. A Canadian astronomer by the name of Ovenden, not only could he predict the orbits of planets, but he could also predict their masses. The mass of the planet that he predicted that should have lied in the asteroid belt would have been of the approximate same mass as the planet Saturn. Van Flandern was led to postulate that this now missing planet, the interestingly enough, 19th century astronomers nicknamed it Krypton.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. So, you know, that opens up a whole host of other connections.
Oh, yes.
You know?
Oh, yes.
This missing planet, Van Flandern postulates, was a water-bearing solid planet. In other words, it may possibly have been the home to intelligent life. On that basis, then, I speculate that, well, if that's the case, then that life is possibly going to be of much larger physiology. In other words, giants. Are there any giant remains? Because, of course, biblical and Sumerian traditions, as well as some Meso and South American traditions of Indian tribes over here, indicate that these giants came down, of course, from heaven and interbred with humanity and sired very large offspring. There are, in fact, some rather astonishing giant remains. Even St. Augustine of Hippo, believe it or not, talks about some of these things. Possibly this planet was home to intelligent life of that sort. One of the texts I cite at great length in the book is the so-called exploits of Ninurta from the Sumerian. This is a very strange text, if it's a mythological text, because what it consists of is rather like a very dry bureaucrat's report on the technology that was inventoried by the victors in this ancient war as they went in and took apart the technology of the vanquished party. It's rather like reading one of those American or British intelligence reports as they went inside of Nazi Germany at the end of World War II. You know, and this goes on for pages and pages, Henrik. You know, it's it's very, very dry reading. But it's interesting because what they're doing is they're taking a technological inventory. And again, this rings very true because the Allies did precisely the same thing at the end of World War II. We wanted to find out what technology the enemy had, why in some areas they were so advanced, you know, what made all of this work. And in some cases we destroyed that technology. In other cases we simply carted it home and continued working on it.
Yeah.
This is exactly what happens in the Sumerian text.
I mean, again, there are so many tablets that has been found throughout the years and so forth, but how did you go about, so to speak, kind of, you know, picking the good ones, so to speak? Or how, rather, my question is, how much information actually is out there and how much is available?
There is a lot available and a lot that has been translated, but, you know, you ask a very good question because my impression is, just from the research I did, is that no more than maybe 5 to 10% of it has been translated. The rest of it is still, there's such an enormous volume of it that has yet to be translated and released in a public fashion that, you know, and that, in a certain sense, that does raise some eyebrows of suspicion, too. I recall that when America and Britain went into Iraq in this debacle that that continues to occur there.
Yeah, unfortunately.
That one of the first things that was done was that notice was served to the French and Germans, you know, to get your archaeological teams out of there. And in digging through the reports on the Baghdad Museum looting, I discovered that, that the Germans were keeping the catalog of the things that they had unearthed for Saddam Hussein. So, you know, even that catalog is as far as I've been able to trace thus far, is not really publicly available. So we don't know really what was taken during that looting, and to be frank with you, I'm a little suspicious that the supposed return of items that were looted, if they were in fact the same items. The whole affair just has a very, very bad ring to it, a bad odor to it.
Could there be hints or suggestions among these artifacts on how to actually construct weaponry, and could there be things that, you know, today's more, I guess, esoteric slash occult kind of researchers within the military are looking for?
Oh yes, definitely, I think so. One of the things I do in the Cosmic War is I explore in the Edfu Egyptian texts and in the Sumerian texts the motivations for that war. And one of the interesting things that comes out in those texts, Henrik, is that the motivation for the war is in part the possession of the technology to wage that war in the first place. The Sumerian texts in particular are full of references to what are called the Tablets of Destinies. And I know some of your listeners that are familiar with the works of Sitchin will recognize that term. These tablets, whatever they were, gave their possessors enormous, extraordinary power. On each occasion of their theft, they're actually stolen, from what I can tell, either two or three different times in history. The first time by Tiamat, which occasions a war between her and her allies, and Marduk and his allies. And then there is a second theft by Anzu, or Zu, depending on which version of the text that you read, his name varies slightly. And that again leads to a war, and it's that second war, in fact, that is fought with Ninurta opposing him, that leads to this inventory of the stones, so to speak, that were part of this technology, whatever it was. They describe manipulation of emotions. They describe manipulation of weather. they describe the destruction of entire celestial bodies, in other words, planets. So in other words, this is a very sophisticated, very powerful technology. Once Ninurta has possession of them, he inventories them. He destroys some of them so that they can't ever be used again. Some of them can't be destroyed. Then he decides that he's going to hide them. Somewhere in that part of the world, something still may exist of that technology. Maybe they were really talking about weapons of mass destruction of a very different and much more ancient sort. Akurs or ziggurats or pyramids are always associated with this technology of mass destruction. The Great Pyramid shows definite signs that there were things inside of it that are now missing, that were at some point in the distant past removed. I refer specifically to those very strange slots that exist in the Grand Gallery and to the niche in the Queen's Chamber and so on that looks as if they were receptacles for something. We don't know what. And, of course, Chris Dunn has hypothesized, and I think plausibly so, that they were some sort of resonator assemblies, at least in the Grand Gallery. So I think if we couple that with this whole idea of the Tablets of Destinies and then the inventory of the Stones of Power and so on that are talked about in the exploits of Ninurta, that we see definite signs that these two technologies were coupled together in some fashion, and that the texts seem to support the idea that something was removed at least from the Great Pyramid, if not from other pyramids or structures in the region. You can kind of trace this civilization to various combatants if you equate these people to their celestial bodies. Because Tiamat, of course, is very similar to the Hebrew word Tehom, which means the ancient primeval waters. So in other words, in Sitchin's reading, in Van Flandern's reading, in my reading, that would refer to Krypton, this exploded planet, a water-bearing large planet. You would have that planet, Mars, which in Van Flandern's theory may have been a satellite of that planet, which would account for its very eccentric orbit once it's released by the explosion of that planet. And it would account for the sudden hemispheric-wide scouring and flooding that appears to have occurred on Mars very suddenly at some point. You would have those two celestial bodies. You would have also, in addition, if you factor in the Greeks and the wars of the Titans with this, you would factor in Saturn. And on the other side, you would have Earth, the moon system, and the sun itself. So in other words, this is something that, if you follow the texts and their astrological and astronomical associations carefully, you can kind of even pin down to particular celestial bodies that are at war with each other. Now, it's interesting that Saturn enters the picture here. Richard Hoagland, the famous Face on Mars expert, fellow who's been examining all of these artifacts on the Moon and Mars very carefully, he has published a paper on his website, and I would urge your listeners to consult it. It's called A Moon with a View, and it's all about the moon Iapetus of Saturn. And you really have to see these pictures. I reproduce them in the book of Iapetus. For one thing, this moon has straight edges. In other words, you can look at the horizon of this body, and instead of seeing a nice curved surface and lots of craters, what you're seeing are nice straight edge ruler type things that, you know, just don't exist in nature. The second thing you see is a very large straight line ridge running along the equator of the body, and in fact three parallel straight lines that rise above this thing. You see hexagonal craters all over the place. So in other words, you're seeing something that very likely is an artificial body. And the pièce de résistance, I reproduce this picture in the book, is that if you look at Iapetus, a famous photo that the Cassini probe took and that NASA actually released, which surprises me no end, is that this straight line ridge with a huge hexagonally shaped crater above it, Hoagland puts this next to the Death Star from George Lucas's Star Wars film, and it doesn't really comment, he just puts it out there.
Yeah.
But the resemblance, you know, when I saw this, Henrik, my jaw literally hit the floor.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the resemblance is just too palpable. It's just too uncanny. And were it not for the fact that it's coming from someone like Hoagland and from a picture that NASA itself released, I'd be disinclined to believe it altogether.
Yeah.
But in terms of the cosmic war hypothesis, it fits very neatly into the picture because it explains all the references to Saturn and the involvement of that celestial body and its satellites in this war. If Iapetus is an artificial body and it has every appearance of being, then again, we are dealing with an extraordinarily sophisticated, very, very ancient civilization.
I actually remember that there was another or several objects found that actually was dated. They were found here on Earth, and they actually looked just like Iapetus do, basically, with a not a ridge, maybe, but a small an inversion, basically, that the Death Star has. You know, this little channel, basically, that it goes around.
Oh yes, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Okay.
These were referred to in I believe Thompson and Cremo's book. These little balls were discovered in a geological layer in South Africa, if I recall correctly.
Said to be a fantastic 2.8 billion years old.
We're talking something extremely ancient, but the odd thing is, as you pointed out, that one of these balls, they're all so perfectly spherical that they are most likely the product of some sort of technology and machining. But one of them in particular has, oddly enough, three parallel ridges running along the equator of this little sphere, and above it there's this little pit or crater indented. There is some sort of relationship, there's some sort of civilization with a very advanced technology that existed long ago.
That's right. Yeah, it's absolutely fascinating when these kind of connections are made. And again, they date this to 3 billion years old, but again, who knows how long, you know, Iapetus has been out there and around. So again, this could be some kind of retelling of the story. Someone has seen something and actually made small sculptures of the thing, you know, who knows?
Right. Well, even, you know, I even mentioned in the Cosmic War that this may be a kind of a child's toy model. Who knows?
Yeah.
You know, but again, the real point is that the resemblance of these things, the occurrence of the mention of these particular celestial bodies in those texts that refer to a war, it all comes together because, of course, to fight a war of that nature, you're going to have some very sophisticated physics. You're going to have some very sophisticated technology. By the nature of the case, you're going to have to be an interplanetary civilization. And by the nature of the case, you're going to have to find some evidence of artificial structures, of the products of intelligence on those celestial bodies. And this is, in fact, what we find.
what we're looking at, an interplanetary civilization. Literally blew itself apart.